There's a movie, obviously, that stood out for me, which was How the West Was Won, that I came and sat and watched when I was 7 years old. Ah! Next thing you knew, I would be, like, tackling my pillow, or I would be, like, skirting across this and jumping onto my dog. And of course, his life was miserable. As a result of all the cowboy movies that I would see for the wrestling and the fighting. It's important to say that most of the Westerns didn't speak to me, though, truly. They weren't very good. They just filled time. There was so many of them made. It took somebody like Kasdan that understood very well the themes and the ideas that actually tied into you, and that's a real art form to kind of disseminate all the Westerns that are there and the themes that are around them and isolate them and give them some kind of a coherence and an entertainment value. Well, Silverado came to me as a result of Lawrence Kasdan having, you know, he's a writer, director, and we had participated together in The Big Chill, and I didn't have the obvious success that comes with being in a hit movie because I wasn't in the movie. And I've heard it told that, you know, he promised me that he would write me something. I don't remember that promise. What I remembered was just a really incredible experience on The Big Chill. And I felt that his commitment to me had been honored. So in a way, to me, it's even more special when he was done with his draft, asked me to be this character, which was a young guy full of juice.
Howdy, Jake.
Evan! Oh, I'm glad to see you.
Be back. Go. What's going on here?
You got me. This is a crazy town, Evan. I think we ought to just get out of here. I mean, all I did was kiss a girl.
And I just have to say that I remember at first being disappointed with the role. And I'll tell you why. Because I had grown up and the roles that I had responded to were the taciturn Westerner, you know, Shane and John Wayne. And those were the characters that I watched. The movies were orchestrated around them. So I knew in my heart how to play the lead guy, how he would move, how he would arbitrate problems in a physical way and in a verbal way in a Western. And suddenly I read the part of Jake and he's all over the place. He's like a monkey, you know, jumping onto the bars and a sense of forgetfulness, almost like a child and a child in a man's body.
No, not exactly, because see, then his friend opened up on me.
What friend's that?
It's the one with the shotgun.
The dead one.
The difference between a scene-stealing part, though, is a part that's designed for it, as opposed to an actor who's taking every scene that he has and trying to steal focus. This part was designed to be really clever and catchy, and I finally absorbed that and eternally grateful for that part.
Making a big mistake.
That's what I told him.
The great writing, I think the work is done for you. And there's a lot of people that talk about movies and they say, you know, if you can get the writing right and you can cast it right, the director's job is about 90% done. Well, now I've directed and I want to beg to differ because you're getting up so early in the morning and the questions never end. It seems like the days are endless and all the pressure falls on your shoulders. But there is a certain truth to that, that if you write it correctly and cast it right, it starts to really take care of itself. Whether you have the camera in the optimum spot or you've edited it perfectly, the play is still the thing. And so I think that's Larry's skill, is that writing characters that are really realized and they intertwine.
Hey, Payton. Where you been?
No, I was just checking the, you know, looking in.
Jeez, Payton, our old man ain't even cold yet.
When something's great, it seems to fuse you as an actor. The same way when you play with a really great player, you seem to play better. And so the better the screenplay, I think the more ideas you have. And oftentimes a director can absorb all the good ideas that you would have. For instance, I remember having a very good idea. I know it to this day, it was a good idea. And I could just see Larry shaking his head going, knowing probably it was a good idea, but it would have ruined his day in terms of trying to film it. And it was the scene where I actually break out of the jail and the town starts to cut loose and people are shooting left and right. And there's the one character that I shoot back up the stairs, Todd Allen, a friend of mine. There was a moment in time that I just liked that Jake was able to handle things. And when he heard that someone was upstairs shooting at his brother across the street, that he just shot through the ceiling, and all of a sudden you had the light holes come right by the guy, and he just suddenly stops. And then I jump on the horse and I do whatever I do or whatever. But it was starting to understand that Jake, aside from his childishness and his unbound enthusiasms, could handle a lot of things when things went badly. You know, there's some guys that aren't very good in that situation. There's some guys that, like, suddenly everything slows down for them. And so Jake doing that. And so I could see Larry thinking, oh God, now I got to put the camera upstairs and the holes. And it was like, what's sweet is he always just starts to laugh first. He just laughs because he can't get to it. And I obviously can appreciate that, but he always listened, to everything, and he had really good ideas for me. But, Larry's kind of presence and leadership, actors would like to be in a Western, a good one. They just want to be in a costume party. They want to be in a great, great Western, and he created a... as he did in The Big Chill, and I think all of his movies, he creates a sense of company and a sense of the thing that needs to happen between actors is everybody has to drop their ego, even though everyone has a healthy one. They have to drop it for the good of the piece. I know what I'm going to do if no one's going to help me. Meaning, I'll know what to do, and if the director's really good, then the director can really help me, and if the actors are really graceful and helpful, then they'll help you too. And so, you come and you wait to see. And Scott immediately created that sense of brother, that he was my older brother. If there was anything on the set, it was gonna fall my way. And there was a couple times, where he actually stepped in and things that were probably he was the only one that could do it at that moment and step in and say, no, this is. Wait a second, this is what he should be doing and not anybody else doing it. And I was very grateful for that.
Look, Ma!
Kevin probably, as an actor, has more tools than anybody that I've worked with. I think he's just really gifted. And he's physical. And he's graceful, and he's clever with his hands, and he was lucky, as we all were lucky, to be in a Western. Larry, again, helped to accentuate his skills.
What's the trouble here?
Stay out of this, Peyton.
He can't do that, Tyree. Cobb's hired him.
That's Cobb's mistake.
Come on out of there, Phoebe. You've done enough.
Go on home, Jake.
All I did was kiss the girl.
If you couldn't make that part work, then you're not really an actor. And my biggest fear was that I wouldn't make it work.
What's the matter, Peyton? You afraid I couldn't get those two behind me?
I don't want you getting anybody in my place.
Boom.
I wasn't sure how to get started with Jake, because Jake didn't seem to really relate to anybody but himself. Somebody's saying that, you shot a guy, and he's going, yeah, but that guy kissed a girl. You can see that he's not on the same page with everybody. So it's not always what you'd call value for value acting, meaning you say something and I say something intelligent back to you. You say, I'm going to kill you. I say, yeah, but you're really ugly. And you go, ooh, where does that fit? So really what happened was, who did Jake relate to in the movie? I felt that Jake started to relate to the horizon, that the big old West was not, was as anything that he could throw at the West, Jake could handle. And so I started to not relate to anybody but the horizon. I wanted to compete with the horizon of the West. And so he was a big character. It's one thing to say something stylized, and it's another thing to pull it off. Because everybody can say they'd like to do a stylized Western, but couldn't pull it off. It takes like a really careful mind to be able to do that, a really crafted filmmaker to be able to get the four guys riding together and for you not to think it's hokey, but that you want it to happen. You know, when the four guys meet up and start to ride. Orchestrating those moments, that's an art form, to take something and stylize it and make it watchable. It can slip off the track so quickly that actually, it's maybe not even quite appreciated how hard it was to create a matinee kind of movie, and find those singular moments and that just make you smile, make you go back in time, make you remember, and also hold you as a contemporary audience, not an audience in the '60s, but a contemporary audience that can live and watch that movie.
This a friend of yours?
He is now.
Who is he?
Oh, a gal got run out of town.
Just like us.
We have a tendency to think of the West post-Civil War. The West was populated a lot with African Americans. They moved. They were smart. They went to where they could be received. I mean, Native Americans received black people more treated them with more respect than we did, although our country fought over the issue. So it's easy to generalize that everyone is racist. Make no mistake, we still have racism is seeps through this country, and so I thought it was smart that Larry placed that.
Malachi, I'm living like a wild cat in a cave in them hills, hiding out. Afraid to walk my own land.
What about the law?
Whose law? The law here runs a man down just like these cattle. That ain't right.
Larry was able to orchestrate those moments, and I think without making it a picture about, you know, African Americans, you know, because that picture's got to be made by somebody else. Or that story doesn't handle those issues. So there are some people that go, oh, well, it was kind of lightweight as far as that was concerned. So untrue. I mean, hats off to Larry for even including it and getting at it a little bit. He got at it just a little bit, just like he got at all our characters, just a little bit.
I haven't had a drink of whiskey or slept in a bed in 10 days.
He ain't getting it here.
Real sorry to hear that.
Doesn't look quite fair.
Which way do you mean?
It's a big, fat piece of entertainment. And those who have found Silverado have really, been happy that they had. And it's a movie that people like to share. I do remember one moment, and I learned a lot from it. It's actually when we ride up on the wagon train. There's the four of us. And we come riding, and we had to do it like 15 times. And then we get to about the last take, and we come riding up, and I think, hey, everything's pretty good. I could tell everything's pretty good. And I'm thinking to myself, and probably this is where my director's hat was being formed, I was thinking, this one's pretty good, you know, this one's pretty good as I'm writing up, you know, everybody's kind of got their shit together and it's pretty good. And then we hit our mark and I think, yeah, that's pretty good. Everybody gets off their horse and I saw that everybody gets off. I get off mark, a wind hits, it blew my serape right up over my face like a little girl's dress in the schoolyard. And then we walk up and I hear Larry go, cut, good, we got it. And I'm thinking, you gotta be kidding me. I've done 10 of these things perfect. This last one, the serape, I knew it. I swear to God, I knew that that was gonna be the take he was gonna keep. And I went, I said, you know, he goes, no, it's gonna be fine. But in truth, I learned something from that, you know, moment, because it's in there and you'll see it if you look at it. It's just briefly, but I was sick about it. There's also a moment in Silverado that bears mentioning. It's not a favorite moment of mine. It comes off a favorite moment of me killing both guys, which is when you're in the theater, people just went crazy for that moment. It was such a correct architecture for that character. It was kind of an unbelievable scene in the sense that it was not that realistic, but it was the follow-up moment where I made a really big mistake as an actor. And my hat's off to Larry because he allowed me to make the mistake just simply because I was. I had now played this role, whatever you say, 96 days of this guy full of juice. I now kill these two guys. Larry wanted me to smile really big when the camera came on me. You know, like, I killed him. And in retrospect, I think he was right. But I couldn't do it. And I said to him, Larry, I've done this the whole movie. I've been Jake. I've been swinging. I said, I've just killed two guys. I want my face to not be like I killed them, you know, which didn't seem right to me, didn't seem realistic. He said, okay. And so I didn't. And the moment plays fine. It just doesn't play great. You could tell that probably the audience wanted me to go, I killed him. I killed him deader than shit, both of them. Way to go, Jake. And the audience wanted that moment. And so what did I learn? I learned that he was right. I also learned, you know, that you know, the tone of the movie wanted that moment. I was right, I think, intellectually about you're not so happy after you do something like that and, you know, blah, blah, blah. But the tone of the movie could have absorbed a moment that wasn't exactly realistic. I think Larry allowed that because the relationship we had was a really good one. For instance, when I went and hid behind the bar, I had dreamed the night before that I would come out without my boots on because I wanted to be quiet, you know, when I come, so I dreamed that. And I saw that in my dream that my boots weren't on. And so when I come flying back over the bar, I landed quietly. And that would always lodge me into what I felt were survival instincts. And that survival instinct works perfectly in that tone of movie anyway. You know, it's like, wow, Jake's got his shit together a little bit. That kind of thing was from dreaming about the part that I had. I would dream in my trailer, you know, because you keep trying to add things to it that don't make the picture fatter, that just exists within the moments that Larry has opportunities had given me. And there was one thing that actually eluded me, which was a scene where I go riding across the yard after I've been captured at McKendrick's ranch, and I come bursting out of the barn, and here comes Jake again, and he jumps up onto the porch. But it was interesting because it goes, here comes Jake, you know, and you could actually hear the music in your head, dun, 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 and he's blazing with both six guns. And it suddenly dawned on me that if both of my guns are going off, I don't have any hands on the reins. Because Larry wrote it, two guns blazing, I really accept that, you know, and so it's up to me to figure out how to do that and for it to make it so that he doesn't, you know, that it just is exciting and it's fun and it's Saturday morning matinee. And then every boy wants to be Jake.
Come on, Arky, jump! Come on! Yeah!
Young people are caught in that world of being, having forced to be adults and then still having a boyish quality. And that's where Jake existed, that his friends could be in terrible trouble and he's doing giant swings on a bar trying to get laid. Yeah. This was probably one of the funnest movies I'd ever worked on. If I look at that picture, I can remember that time, and it was a good time for me. And it was a good time for those people, all the people involved. I've gone on to have other great things happen to me, but that movie ranks right at the top for me, as an experience and an opportunity to be in a Western and to have a great character and friendships that were forged. And so it was the big attention getter for me, to be honest. I think No Way Out and Untouchables did something else. I think Silverado was a who was that role.